What's up, you guys? It's Graham here. So I think it's no surprise that lately the entire stock market is acting as though it's been flipped upside down and nothing makes sense. The other day, Yahoo Finance posted this mouth-watering article with the title, "The Worst Stocks Are Doing the Best." And I gotta say, the contents of this article are both incredibly concerning and it also kind of makes some sense. And how is it possible to invest when you want to be a responsible adult who properly diversifies with a long-term mindset? But you also see people making a fortune riding the exhilarating momentum of the next hot stock, with rocket emojis next to it and diamonds. Like, seriously, if you want to show your level of conviction for an investment, just go and put a rocket emoji, a diamond, and a moon immediately after. It's kind of like the stock market equivalent to putting racing stripes on your car to make it faster. So obviously, I think this is a topic worth discussing further, so that way we could talk about exactly why the stock market doesn't make any sense right now, what's caused this to happen, how some investors are using this information to make a stupid amount of money. And then finally, we can answer the impossible question, why the worst stocks are doing the best. But first, I just need a quick favor from you. If you wouldn't mind destroying the like button for the YouTube algorithm, it would help me out a ton. For those that are not aware, the more engagement a video like this gets, the more likely the YouTube algorithm is to push it out to a brand new audience. And we're so close to 3 million subscribers, it's insane. So if you wouldn't mind, just it takes a quick second, smash the like button, it helps me out a ton. It's totally free to do. And in return, I promise to keep bringing you 3 videos every single week. So now let's begin with the article that inspired all of this, and that would be the claim that the worst stocks are now the ones doing the best. They say all of this began in the middle of the shutdown when businesses were forced to close down, travel was halted, hospitality grind to a standstill, and for the most part, a lot of small businesses just had to fend for themselves. That led a large portion of the market to pull out of their investments within those companies and instead place it within companies that were more likely to weather through the pandemic, and that would be tech. The logic was that when everyone is staying home and people are working remote and everything is shut down, people are going to be more likely to use websites like Twitter, Facebook, Google, Zoom, and so on. And because of that, a lot of money shifted over to the digital work from home space, thereby driving up the price. It's almost as though people didn't want to invest in brick and mortar businesses anymore because it was too risky. And when tech was going up 5% a day while everything else just dropped in price, it caused a lot of people to move with the tide and look for greener pastures. But thankfully, a few months ago, things started turning around. Tech company valuations began growing beyond people's wildest imaginations, causing a lot of investors to take a step back and wonder, how much more room is there for growth, and where will be the next big opportunity? Well, cue the vaccine. When a vaccine was announced, people began seeing the next big opportunity in recovery stocks, or basically hard-hit companies that have been shut down and would benefit from the economy reopening. This is what some economists refer to as the Great Rotation, as people move their money away from tech and into recovery stocks, further driving up the price. And even though that seems reasonable on the surface, investors have been taking that to an extreme by buying up the worst companies possible that are literally days from financial ruin and then sending them soaring up in value. But the wealth management firm Credit Suisse seems to think that they've identified exactly what investors look for in terms of which stock is about to rocket to the moon. And this is what their data has shown us. They say that first of all, the company should have deteriorating finances, questionable business practices, and preferably a lot of debt. It also helps if those companies experience large sell-offs during periods of stress combined with poor use of investor capital, and if you think I'm joking, I'm not. Since the announcement of the vaccine on November 6th, the stocks with high short interest have almost doubled the performance of the stocks with low short interest. Or in other words, the stocks that most people believe are going to drop are the stocks that end up going up the most in price. The other metrics include screening for stocks with high volatility, shares of a company that produce a low return on assets, and stocks with the biggest 52-week drop in price. Or in more simple terms, if the price of the stock goes up and down a lot and it's near its 52-week low, that's a bullish sign apparently. And if you felt this was just limited to gamblers on Reddit who want to take the biggest risk possible, it's not. Throughout the entire stock market, analysts have been predicting a decrease in company earnings, which would normally be a bearish sign that stocks might begin to sell off ahead of time. But nope, the stock market kept going up despite the bad news. Although when earnings actually did come out, and 81% of companies have beat expectations by an average of 15.2%, stocks didn't continue going up on the good news. Oh no. When good news came out, those stocks actually dropped by an average of 0.5% within the following 2 days. Joel Greenblatt even explained that if you had bought every company that lost money in 2019 with a market cap of over $1 billion, and there's 261 of them, you would be up 65% so far this year. Yes, you heard me correctly, you would be up 65% by investing in billion-dollar companies that lost money in 2019. This type of reaction is not normal, according to Bank of America, which found that historically, good news like this should increase the price of the stock by an average of 1%, not drop it. Case in point, Disney. On Friday, Disney surpassed expectations by seeing a huge boost in new paid subscribers and are soon looking forward to the park's reopening. But on that good news, which you would think is good for the stock price, the stock actually went down 1.5%. The thinking around this is that maybe investor expectations are so high that if a company does not completely blow it out of the water beyond what people expect, the stock is then going to sell off and go down in price. It's almost as though the bar was set so high that the best possible outcome was already priced in. So once the good news came out, people began to sell off because now what else is there to look forward to? But economists are starting to warn that this type of behavior is a sign of something perhaps more ominous as valuations become completely detached from fundamentals. And as CNN says, market euphoria is everywhere. Low interest rates are causing investors to look everywhere they can for the next big opportunity. And with optimism around the economy reopening, there's the mindset that it's almost impossible to lose money. And to up the ante, margin investing, or when you invest using debt, has recently hit an all-time record high. Now sure, we might be able to justify that interest rates are at the lowest point they've ever been, so it makes some sense to borrow money and then invest it. But the reality is that margin investing is going to magnify whatever the market is already doing, so that could cause the price to go even higher, or subsequently, fall even lower. But we should really talk about why all of this is happening in the first place, and then of course what you could do about it. Now here's the thing, usually when it comes to these things, I'm gonna back it up with a lot of data and research behind it, but for something like this, it's still so new that there wasn't much I could accurately pull from. So instead, I'm just gonna give my own take on this as some random guy on YouTube is just filming videos on a weekday afternoon. So first, we gotta talk about that good old stimulus. Now I think that low interest rates and massive stimulus packages were necessary to keep the economy afloat. But no surprise, it threw the entire economy out of whack. When big corporations and banks and airlines and restaurants receive billion-dollar bailouts, it really begins to distort the market in terms of how companies should be valued and where they should be trading at. It's like giving coffee to a child and then wondering why they're acting so hyper. The market just got a huge dose of money, and when you combine that with low interest rates, it's no wonder the market is doing what it is. Now, second, we gotta talk about margin. When interest rates are really low, people are encouraged to borrow more money, and I think this makes sense, and it can be done responsibly. But many people forget the risks that you are literally borrowing money to buy an investment that has the potential to go down in value. Now, depending on what you're investing in, and for how long, and at what interest rate, it might be worth it, and that's one of the reasons why I refuse to pay off my 2.5% 30-year fixed-rate mortgage. But with more money entering the stock markets on debt, it's inevitable that that is going to rise prices alongside it. Now, third, we gotta talk about why the worst stocks are doing the best. Right now, I feel like a lot of people are looking for the next big opportunity. We've seen companies like Zoom 5x in price, and with the economy reopening, there's the expectation that really hard-hit companies with really bad financials that everyone has seemed to have overlooked will eventually end up doing much better. I also think there's a bit of the mindset of, why would I invest in a company that's already up 300% in a year when I could buy the company that's dropped in value 90% and has room to grow much more? It just seems like people are viewing really bad financials as just translating into higher upside, and that's driving up the price. Now fourth, my favorite one from all of them, meme stocks. There is now a brand new type of investor out there who does not buy on fundamentals or analysis or data, but instead, they trade on the momentum and excitement of what people are talking about online. Every week, it seems like there's a new hot stock that everyone begins clamoring about. Then of course, people pile in, the price goes up, and within a few weeks, the price comes crashing down as people move on to the next one. I wouldn't necessarily call it a pump and dump, but there's this genuine level of excitement and humor around buying the next meme stock. And a lot of people buy in because they see that as an easy way to make money as fast as possible. Now fifth, we gotta talk about the news. Right now, it seems like the more news coverage a stock gets, whether it be positive or negative, the more likely that stock is to move. But once a stock stops getting that attention, people tend to grow bored. They're tired of it trading within the same range, and then they want to sell off and move into something more volatile that could go up in price faster. Right now, I believe that attention is really moving the markets. And today, more than ever, investors are growing impatient when the stock doesn't pop off in value in a few weeks. And finally, six, there's absolutely the gamification of stocks. I've been saying this throughout all of last year, but lately it seems like the line is getting very much blurred between what people would consider to be gambling and investing. It's all too easy right now for anyone to go on their phone from wherever they are and place some really big bets that could either win big or lose big. These are not investors playing the social aspect with a pre-planned entry and exit point. But instead, these are investors who just want to take a big risk to make as much money as fast as possible. And when you have a market where everything just keeps going up, it's going to reinforce that investing like this is normal and that it's easy and that investing is always going to be this simple. And then, of course, when you're used to these types of gains, you're going to look down at that 20% return annually as being really bad. That's led to this new psychology that people may as well take the risk on really poor performing company with really bad financials and a lot of debt, because that's going to have a lot more upside than another stock which is already at its all-time high. But I will say this, even though it has worked so far, it doesn't mean it always will. And I think none of this behavior is sustainable long-term. Just like stimulus begins to distort the market, this last year has caused a lot of investors to think that what we're seeing now is normal, and it's not. It's so important to take a step back, analyze your portfolio objectively, and really decide if those companies are worth holding on to. If your intention from the beginning was to get in and out, then by all means. But understand that without a plan ahead of time, it starts looking a lot more like gambling than it does investing. But in terms of what you could do about all of this, my advice is fairly simple. Stay invested in the markets. Make sure you diversify. Load up on index funds that won't fluctuate as much in price, and then just ride it through. If you're trading on margin, make sure you're not over-leveraged and you have enough cash on hand to be able to cover it if you need to. For myself, the hype has not stopped me from investing, and I'm still buying into the same old S&P 500 index fund pretty much every day. But I refuse to use margin. I keep a healthy amount of cash on the sidelines just in case something comes up as a safety net. And I'm very much diversified across stocks, index funds, real estate, CDs, cash, and even a little bit of crypto. So even if one part of my portfolio drops, I have the rest of it to fall back on. Now sure, doing that means I'm probably not going to see crazy 100% returns on my money. But call me old, because I believe that slow and steady is going to win the race. I'm honestly so happy that more people now have taken an interest in investing and that personal finance is starting to become kind of cool. Although I'm not a fan of how quickly things are starting to look like a casino. And I would know what a casino looks like because I just moved to Las Vegas. So the best thing we could honestly do is just learn from past mistakes, keep investing if the market goes down, keep investing even if the market goes up, and don't get too carried away trying to chase the next 10 bagger. Investing is really meant to be a long-term game, and when you start thinking of things 20 years from now, sometimes the basic strategies turn out to be the best, like getting your two free stocks down below in the description, because Webull is going to be giving you two free stocks when you deposit $100 on the platform, and those stocks could potentially be worth all the way up to $1,600. So essentially, if you guys want free money, claim those free stocks down below in the description and let me know which free stocks you get. So with that said, you guys, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. As always, make sure to destroy the like button, subscribe button, and notification bell. Also, feel free to add me on Instagram. Posts are pretty much daily, so if you want to be a part of it there, feel free to add me there, as in the second channel, The Graham Stephan Show. I post there every single day. I'm not posting here. So if you want to see a brand new video from me every single day, make sure to add yourself to that. And then, like I said, get your two free stocks down below in the description. Let me know which stocks you get. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time.